Today we salute our veterans, of which I'm delighted to say I am one, in the Korean War. There's some from Vietnam, some from World War II, some, I don't know if there are any World War I veterans. If they were, they're very old now, but some just coming out of the Afghan crisis and the Iraqi war. All of them brave people defending our nation. But the big news is they say it's now being called Snowvember. It's not even winter yet, but parts of the country are freezing in ice, buried under heavy snow, some of the hardest, heaviest snows on record, and a huge Arctic storm is bringing winter to America 1 month early.
And it got very cold very fast in some places. In Denver, the temperature plunged 20 degrees in 30 minutes. Charlene Aron has the story.
The blast of wintry weather swept across the upper Midwest Monday, bringing heavy snow in some areas and plunging temperatures across the region. It's a recipe that's creating widespread chaos for drivers.
I've been sitting here for about 2 hours, and I got, 15 trucks behind me.
In Duluth, Minnesota, icy roads caused a 16-car pileup.
Just kind of a landslide of cars. Everything slid down the hill.
Minneapolis got more than 15 inches of snow Monday, with more on the way. The frigid weather is being pushed in by a powerful storm that hit Alaska with hurricane-force winds over the weekend and is threatening to bury several states in snow and send temperatures as much as 40 degrees below average. 53 was the high in Billings, Montana on Sunday. Monday, it barely hit 20, and a low of only 8 degrees is expected today. The polar cold is bringing lows in the teens and single digits into Iowa, Kansas, and Colorado this week, and freezing temperatures are forecast as far as South Texas. And while most want to put off winter for a few more weeks, some are welcoming it with open arms.
I thought it was really cool, because I haven't seen snow in a really long time.
Forecasters say things will get warmer over the weekend, but they won't stay that way. Another Arctic blast is on the way for next week. Charlene Aron, CBN News.
My. Come to Virginia Beach. It's balmy here. It's just lovely.
Don't speak too quickly. We might get a blizzard tomorrow.
Whatever. Okay. Well, in other news, once again, people in Jerusalem are facing the threat of Palestinian terrorism. But this time, not with bombs or guns. Instead, the terrorists use knives and cars. John Jessup has that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. Here's John.
Pat, Israel says the Palestinian Authority is behind a sharp increase in terror attacks because Palestinian leaders accuse Israel of trying to destroy the Al-Aqsa Mosque. On Tuesday, two Palestinians apparently took that message to heart when they killed two Israelis. Chris Mitchell brings us the latest from Jerusalem.
Palestinians tweeted, "The knife intifada has begun." Knife-wielding Palestinians murdered two Israelis in separate terror attacks on Monday. A terrorist stabbed a 20-year-old soldier to death at a Tel Aviv bus stop in the afternoon. A few hours later, another terrorist stabbed a 26-year-old woman to death at the same bus stop where three Israeli teenagers were kidnapped and murdered by Hamas terrorists in June. They're the latest in a series of Palestinian terror attacks carried out using everyday items like cars and knives to murder Israelis. Israel blames the Palestinian Authority for inciting Palestinians to terror.
This incitement calls for the use of all means, as they call it, in order to make sure that Jerusalem, and especially the Temple Mount, is clean from Jews.
Yossi Kupervaser from the Ministry of Strategic Affairs told journalists earlier that speeches like this one by PA President Mahmoud Abbas, known as Abu Mazen, is causing the trouble.
It is not enough for us to say that there are defenders. We must all become defenders of Al-Aqsa. It is not enough for us to say the settlers might come to Al-Aqsa Mosque. They did come, and they must not be allowed in the complex. We must prevent their entrance into the complex by any means possible.
Hamas, which is part of Abbas's Palestinian government, was more explicit.
Even he who owns nothing but his faith has a kitchen in his house in which he has a knife. He must grab his knife and confront the Zionist enemy. Another one owns no weapon but does own a car. He must push down on the gas pedal in order to take revenge of the settlers who corrupted the land and defiled the Al-Aqsa Mosque. I say there must be an uprising now.
This was in my mind understood by the people on the ground as a license to do things on the ground.
In response to the attacks, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said they would fight the incitement from the Palestinian Authority.
Those who protest against the state of Israel and in favor of the Palestinian state, I say to them, simply move there, to the Palestinian Authority or Gaza. I promise you that the state of Israel will not make it difficult for you. But for those who stay here, we will make it difficult if you are a rioter or a terrorist.
Palestinians claim Al-Aqsa is in danger because a growing number of Jewish Israelis want the right to pray on the Temple Mount. It's the site of two Jewish temples in Bible times, but Palestinians say the temple in Jewish history here never existed. The Israeli government says they'll defer to the Muslims and maintain the status quo. That means for now only Muslims can pray on the coveted plateau. In the meantime, Israelis are dealing with the possibility of terror attacks any place, any time. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Thanks, Chris. Pat, more and more Mideast unrest.
Well, just imagine, ladies and gentlemen, what it would feel like in Chicago or New York or Philadelphia or Los Angeles if everybody was carrying a knife and everybody who rode a bus or rode a subway or walked in a pedestrian mall could be the subject of a knife attack. Now, that's a terrible prospect. I mean, a terrible prospect. What would you do? Would you harm everybody, give everybody a gun, have them all with pistols? I mean, it would be an armed encampment, and there would be terror constantly. Who would want to live in a society like that? Well, you wouldn't. Well, that's what's going to happen in Israel, is these people, every time an Israeli gets on a bus, the person riding next to him, if he happens to be a Palestinian, might stick a knife in his ribs. That isn't a pleasant prospect. And the thing is that the authority, the actual leadership of the Palestinians is calling on its people to stick knives into Israelis. They're asking them to do that. If they haven't got a knife, take a car, drive a car into a group of unarmed civilians and kill them. Now, that isn't a pleasant prospect. Why do we dignify these people? Why do we give them aid? Why do we give them money? Something has to be done, and this Abu Mazen is supposed to be a moderate. Think what would happen if the real terrorists were in control, and it looks like Hamas probably is. So, if there was ever a time to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, it's right now. John?
Pat, Iraq's army has recaptured the heart of a town home to the country's largest oil refinery. State television reports that Iraqi troops have driven out Islamic State extremists from the center of the town of Beji. But a senior military official said clashes continue in other parts of the town. The U.S. said Monday that coalition aircraft conducted 7 airstrikes near Beji since Friday. Well, back here at home, the number of people signing up for insurance programs through Obamacare is falling drastically below expectations. The Department of Health and Human Services now estimates 9.1 million people will sign up next year. That's far below the original 13 million estimate from the Congressional Budget Office. Meanwhile, the man called an architect of the law said it had to be deliberately written in a confusing way so that it would pass. Speaking at a panel discussion, Jonathan Gruber of MIT said preventing people from really understanding what was in the law was necessary so people wouldn't know what was in it and try to stop it.
Lack of transparency is a huge political advantage. And basically, you know, call it the stupidity of the American voter or whatever. But basically, that was really, really critical to getting the thing to pass.
In the video posted by the Daily Caller, Gruber added he wished the process of writing Obamacare could have been more transparent, but he'd rather have the law than not. He also said Obamacare could not be seen as a tax increase or would have died in Congress, but the Obama administration later argued before the Supreme Court that it was indeed a tax. Pat?
Are you shocked? Isn't that shocking? To think that the president of the United States of America and his minions deliberately lied to the American people. And you think of the Nancy Pelosi, the Speaker of the House of Representatives, say, well, we've got to pass the law so we'll find out what's in it. We didn't know. And this group is saying it was deliberately obfuscated so the voter wouldn't understand what was there. And then they had a tax in it, but they covered it up and said, I mean, the president went out and said, it is not a tax. He said it. To think we have the leader of our country who's an out-and-out liar, a repeated liar, with knowledge, with forethought. This isn't some accidental slip of the tongue. These are deliberate lies. And they've got this monstrosity they have settled on the American people, and people are losing their health care, or they're getting their premiums doubled or tripled. I mean, it's just a nightmare for many, many people. And of course, the people rose up in this last election, and they gave a resounding defeat to the Democrats in the election in terms of the Senate and the House and so forth, and governor's races. But nevertheless, this law is still on the books. And so in order to get it out, we've got a president who's got a veto pen. And then they could just chip away a little bit, little bit, little bit. But what a monstrosity. Isn't it? I mean, doesn't it shock you? Isn't that outrageous to have a group that say, we deliberately lied to fool the American people so this huge 1/6 of the American economy could be taken over by the government? Man. That'd make Karl, not Marx, but Lenin, that would make Lenin blanch. That's the way the communists work. John?
Pat, in North Carolina, at least 6 officials have resigned from their jobs rather than be forced to perform same-sex marriage ceremonies. Heather Sell spoke with one magistrate about his decision, what it's cost him, and where he goes from here.
John Callum has worked as a magistrate in rural Rockingham County for over a decade. During that time, he has closely watched the growing momentum of gay marriage and wondered what it might mean for him.
I had told some of my coworkers, if it ever gets down to that, where I'm asked to perform same-sex marriage, I'm not going to be able to do it.
That moment happened last month when a federal judge struck down North Carolina's marriage amendment. Callum told his supervisor, I can't perform a gay marriage. The following day, the state took its stand, comply or lose your job.
I showed up at 4 o'clock, ready for my shift. There was no discussion. It was just two judges reiterating what the administrative or office of the courts had said, this is now the law. We're here to uphold the law. Therefore, you will do it.
Callum says he tried to keep his job, even offering to work the third shift to avoid marrying same-sex couples. But in the end, he felt he had no choice.
You know, Genesis 2:24 is pretty clear, you know, about marriage being instituted by God.
Callum says he relies on the word not only for this decision, but for the future. He and his wife are raising their grandchildren and had counted on his job.
You know, I'm an older person. I'm not a young person. I'm 66 years old. And I know that trying to find a job when you're 66 years old is kind of hard, if not impossible. But nothing is impossible in God's eyes.
His struggle may be just the beginning as gay marriage grows and acceptance for religious liberty fades. North Carolina Senate Leader Phil Berger believes the state courts can accommodate workers like Callum. He's working on legislation that would protect religious beliefs and lead the state courts to reverse course.
I think, unfortunately, what we've seen in North Carolina is a failure on the part of North Carolina to provide an appropriate accommodation for the religious beliefs of magistrates in particular.
For Callum's pastor, the situation has provided a reality check.
I told our congregation that if they can tell a magistrate last week, you have to perform this ceremony, what's to prevent them from telling me next week, I have to do it?
And Callum's stand is also bringing hope and encouragement to his community.
Strangers, people I didn't even know, who came up and said, you know, thank you for standing up, thank you for taking a position, and we appreciate you and we're praying for you.
Reporting in Rockingham County, North Carolina, Heather Sells, CBN News.
A Dutch man had two wireless computer chips implanted in his body so he could store digital money and use the chips for other purposes like programming an alarm clock. Martin Wismeyer is an entrepreneur, and the London Telegraph reports he decided the chips aren't secure enough yet to use permanently. He says the chips need to be encrypted so that its stored information can't be stolen. But he does call the experiment a success. He says the chips can be used not only for digital currency, but as keys for your house or monitoring your health, even helping call a doctor if you happen to have a heart attack. And he believes people who use the chips are helping to make them socially acceptable. Pat, what do you think? Does this sound a little like end time prophecies?
What does the Bible say? You have a mark of the Antichrist, 666. This is how you do it. You put a chip into somebody that's got all of their medical records, all of their financial records, all of the social records that they have. It can be stored in a tiny little chip. We've now got the technology to do it. It's hard to believe that a system would be so all-pervasive that a person couldn't buy or sell without the mark of the beast. Well, we're getting it. And this Dutchman is showing how it can be done. So read the newspaper and read the book of Revelation.
Republicans are criticizing President Obama's push for what's called net neutrality. The president says the move would keep the internet open and free for everyone. But critics say it will do just the opposite of what the president says, eliminating internet freedom and leading to government regulation of the net. 15 missing hikers from a church group have been rescued and reunited with their families. The group from a Seventh-day Adventist church failed to return Sunday from the San Gabriel Mountains near Los Angeles. They were rescued by helicopter Monday after sending a text message for help. The group had become wet and exhausted, or rappelling down waterfalls, and simply ran out of daylight. Remember, you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website. It's cbnnews.com.